Hello everyone and welcome. The hunt for 300 miles per hour continues, and in this video we're going to be talking about whether or not the Hennessey Venom F5 will be capable of hitting that magic 300 mile per hour mark. Now there's two things we got to be talking about here. First of all, does it have enough power to hit that based on its specifications? And then we're also going to get into tires. So in order to know does it have enough power, there's three things we need to look at. What is the aerodynamic drag on the vehicle at 300 miles per hour? What's the rolling resistance? And what are the drivetrain losses? And from that we can see whether or not its twin turbo V8 producing 1600 horsepower plus is enough to propel this vehicle all the way to 300 miles per hour. Now, some other specifications. The car weighs 2,950 pounds, or about 1,338 kilograms, has a coefficient of drag of just 0.33, and it has a frontal area of 1.83 meters squared. The claims here are 0 to 400 to back down to 0 kilometers per hour in less than 30 seconds. You'll notice that's faster than the Koenigsegg record, which was just set, and a top speed of 301 miles per hour, also higher than the Koenigsegg record of 277 miles per hour, which was also just set. So starting things off with aerodynamic drag, in order to calculate how much power you need to overcome drag, this is equal to the force of drag multiplied by the velocity at which you're traveling at, of course in this case 300 miles per hour. Now the force of drag is equal to 1/2 rho, the density of air, v squared, velocity, coefficient of drag, multiplied by your area, and then all of that multiplied by the velocity you're traveling at. That gives us 1/2 times 1.225 kilograms per meter cubed. That's the density of air at sea level at 15 degrees Celsius, multiplied by 134.1 meters per second. That cubed, that's the velocity we're traveling at, so we're taking v squared, multiplying also by v cubed. 134 meters per second is equivalent to 300 miles per hour, multiplying that by 0.33, and then multiplying that by the frontal area, 1.83 meters squared. I'm sure all of you are very happy. We're using metric units here for the most part. So this, if you do the math, comes out to about 892 kilowatts, or about 1196.5 horsepower. So that's the amount of power we need just to overcome aerodynamic drag, and we do have quite a bit left, you know, about 400 horsepower left over after you take out aerodynamic drag. So moving on to rolling resistance, and once again, the power required for rolling resistance is going to be equal to the force of rolling resistance multiplied by the velocity which we're traveling at. That force of rolling resistance is equivalent to the coefficient of rolling resistance multiplied by the normal force multiplied by velocity. So in our case, using a conservative 0.015 for the coefficient of rolling resistance, multiplying that by the mass of the car, 1338 kilogram, multiplied by gravity, 9.81 meters per second. This combined is our normal force, and then multiplying that by velocity, 134 meters per second, or 300 miles per hour. And you do the math there, and that gives you a total of 26.4 kilowatt, or about 35.4 horsepower. Now, there's not actually a linear relationship between the power to overcome rolling resistance and the velocity at which you're traveling at, like this insinuates, but we'll get more into that later when we start talking about tires. So for now, we're going to use this 35.4 horsepower figure, add that to 1196.5, and that gives us 1231.9 horsepower. We do the math, divide that by 1600, that gives us about 77%. So what that tells us is we have 23% drivetrain losses, which we could accept and still reach 300 miles per hour. And it's very unlikely, you know, this car is rear-wheel drive, it's unlikely that it's going to have 23% drivetrain losses. It'll probably be significantly less than that, and as a result, it shouldn't have a problem reaching 300 miles per hour from a power standpoint. It should have plenty of reserve power in order to hit that target mark. But the tires, on the other hand, will be a challenge. And the reason being is because tires get very hot, especially at these really high speeds. And so if the tires exceed their vulcanization temperature, about 177 degrees Celsius, or about 350 degrees Fahrenheit, if the tire reaches that temperature, they start to degrade and they start to fail. And so this is what you don't want to happen. Now, 35.4 horsepower is what's going into that tire, and that is a lot by itself. But actually what happens is, as you get above 100 kilometers per hour, about 100 kilometers per hour, this equation isn't entirely accurate. Your coefficient of rolling resistance is going to start increasing. And so it'll increase exponentially as you get into those higher speeds. Now, this is because of aerodynamic drag, which of course increases with the square of speed, as we learned from our earlier equation. And it's also because of the vibrations that occur at high speeds. So that tire is now rotating at a faster speed. It deforms it more. Those deformations cause it to, you know, generate more heat. So there's really two things that you want in a tire that are going to be going at this super fast speed. You need a low hysteresis, which means a low rolling resistance, not much heat that goes into, not much waste heat in that tire. But you also want high grip, of course, for a tire that, you know, that's going to be on this, you know, extreme performance car. And these two can kind of battle against each other, high grip versus low rolling resistance. You also want a high natural frequency of that tire. You don't want the vehicle speed to reach the natural frequency of that tire, or it's going to start forming waves within the tire, and then the tire is going to start to fail from all the heat that those waves are creating. So you want a light tire, and you also want a stiff tire, and these two once again battle against each other. Now, Jalopnik actually wrote a really great article. They did some great research on tires. If you're curious, I'll include a link talking more about the tire aspect of it in the video description. But overall, from a power standpoint, the math does show, you know, that reasonably, you know, this number could be significantly higher and they would still have plenty of leftover power, even with drivetrain losses, to hit it. So from a V8, you know, the twin turbo 1600 horsepower plus engine and the low curb weight, what's really impressive, honestly, is that they got their drag coefficient so low and their frontal area so low. So in a previous video, I said, you know, can a car hit 300 miles per hour? How much power will it need? Well, I used the Bugatti Veyron as the example, and that turned out to be about 1800 horsepower. Now, that car has more weight, it has more frontal area, and it has a higher drag coefficient, and that's why that higher horsepower number is required rather than something like 1600, when you can get that drag coefficient down and the frontal area down. So thank you all for watching, and if you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them below.